I've married a Maasai woman from Kenya, and yes, she's married a white person, but it wasn't about the money. It was because we loved each other.
When we met with Brian, everything kind of became history because we were like, we walked across East Africa on foot together for 58 days.
Everyone was very receptive. My parents love Selena. Selena's been to America 3 times and knows my parents and my brother and my cousins and my aunts and my uncles, and they all love her to death.
So we talked, and he went to America, and when he came back, we met, and I took him to my village.
The first time I met Selena's father, I'll never forget, he took a Maasai blanket and he put it over my head like he was going to whisper a secret to me. And right when he was about to speak, he just started spitting in my face, right into my face. And I was shocked. I was like, I was just like blown away. I had no idea what was going on. As it turns out, as I later found out, spitting is a blessing in Maasai.
I have never witnessed a love story like this before. This man was born into a wealthy family in America. He had many opportunities and enjoyed a lot of comforts, but he left it all behind to live in Africa and marry a Maasai girl who was born in a completely different world.
Growing up, I was in a purely nomadic pastoralist family. And for us, as young girls, education was not in our plan.
There was a long distance between them regarding culture, life, and countries. How did these differences bring their story to this point? The beautiful part of their story is that they both came wonderful family and had this lovely baby girl. Many people thought it was impossible, but they have become a very prosperous family because they live in an extraordinarily beautiful place everyone enjoys visiting. How was this possible? How did they meet? And why did this man decide to leave his luxurious life in America to come here? To learn more, I traveled 10 kilometers from Narok Town, Kenya, to the Maasai Mara National Reserve. The Maasai Mara National Reserve is famous for its rich wildlife and stunning landscapes. This area, where they live, is home to many people from the Maasai tribe. Here is their full story.
My name is Selina Nkoile. I am a young Maasai woman. I was born and raised in Mosiro village in Kajiado West sub-county, but now I reside in Bomanoma Eco Lodge in Narok. Growing up, I was in a purely nomadic pastoralist family, and for us, as young girls, education was not in our plan, but fortunately, an international organization built the first school in my village, and that's how education became my golden opportunity to a better future. And as now, I am a true testimony of transformational power of education, because before I enrolled in the school that was built in my village, I was already reserved for marriage. But when the school was built, and our dads were convinced that girls needed to be given an opportunity to go to school, I think being able to go to school really was like one of the highlights of my life, because I was able to enjoy my childhood, I was able to meet my age mates and study and learn new different things, and get to know different languages. I only knew Maasai as a language, which is my native language, but now I know Swahili, I know English, I can communicate with anyone from the globe who communicates in those two languages on top of my native language. So, yeah, so that makes me a daughter. I'm also a great friend. I am a wife.
My name is Brian, Brian Ash. I come from Ridgefield, Connecticut, in the United States of America, and I've lived here in Kenya for the past 11 years now.
December 2019. This whole thing was one empty field. Not a tree, not a building, just an empty field. Every single thing you see here, we've added from 2020. And the reason that we now have an eco lodge is because we came here in December of 2019 thinking that we were just gonna build a house, a kitchen, and a bathroom for ourselves. But immediately people just started coming and coming and coming and coming and coming. So we had to expand our small home into a full-on eco lodge, which includes now an organic farm. Selena, who has studied permaculture, really planned out the farm and did a beautiful job of farm management. And then I planted every single tree that you see here.
As an American in Kenya, I faced a lot of challenges over the past 10 years, from very small challenges to bigger challenges. Something as small as, it's very hard for me to find genuine friends. Most people, I find they want something from me. When they see me and that I've come from America, they assume that I must have money. So I've had many, many, many people pretend to be my friend, and they're very good at it. I've been fooled many times, and they're my friend, and for this long time, and we're great friends, and then all of a sudden, you know, they want maybe a loan, or they want something, and then once they get whatever they want, they disappear, and I've never seen them again. So it's really hard for me to find genuine friends. So my friend circle here in Kenya is small, but good quality people, which is kind of, I think, better than having a lot of, you know, just acquaintances. Most people in Kenya don't assume that I speak Swahili. So they'll talk about me in front of me. That's happened many times, whether it's in the market, on a bus, walking somewhere, you know, in a restaurant. And most of the time I just listen first. I don't say anything. And when they're done talking, I have created a very funny comeback. And when I say it to them, they are absolutely shocked and embarrassed and tend to just get up and run away because they had no idea that I could understand every single thing that they had been saying about me. So 12 years ago, I came to Kenya for the first time and started a nonprofit organization called ArriveKenya.org, which helps street children and orphans. We built schools and orphanages in Western Kenya. So I lived in Western Kenya for about 6 years until I met my now wife, Selena.
So me and Brian met through our late friend Susan. May her soul rest in eternal peace, and I miss her every day. Susan, she was studying a course in gender studies. And Brian, for the last 8 years, has been doing community development. So he has an American nonprofit that partners with local nonprofit organizations, and they partner on projects. So Susan was one of the interns in his project in in Migori, Kenya. So and then now when Susan was done with her course, she came back. She lives in a neighboring village from mine, and we were both working on a project to end female genital mutilation, child marriage, and teenage pregnancies. And every time I met Susan, she'll be like, "Oh, girl, I think I need to introduce you to Brian. You guys will get along so well." And every time we met, she mentioned Brian, and I'm like, "Who is this Brian? Like, what does he do?" So one time, Brian also had a project in her village, and they would go on excursions and live with the Maasais and also like do stuff there and empower women. So one day I was in Ethiopia doing cultural tourism, and Brian was in Susan's village, and Brian bumped into Susan when he was on a run. So Susan was like, "Hey, Brian, okay, today I have to give you my friend's number and you guys need to talk. So Susan gave Brian my number, and then we started talking to Brian while I was still in Ethiopia, and I was like, okay, and Brian is texting me in Swahili, so Brian knows fluent Swahili. So we started talking, and every year he used to go to the US to visit friends and family and do fundraisers and also like resource mobilization for his organization. It's called Arrive in Kenya. So we talked, and he went to America, and when he came back, we met, and I took him to my village.
When Selena and I first met, we went on some dates together, some that I'll never forget. And, you know, slowly but surely, we fell in love. And at first, you could think it was a challenge for a white person from America to be here in Kenya and be romantically engaged with a woman of the Maasai tribe, because the culture is very different, the customs are very different, and we've both had to make compromises for sure in terms of culture and things that are the norm for the Maasai culture compared to, you know, my American upbringing. But the thing that's helped me the most has been learning Swahili and being able to speak fluently in Swahili for the past 10 years, because without that language barrier, it's very easy for me to connect. It was easy for me to communicate with her late mother, her father, her family. I think when you have cross-cultural relationships, sometimes a very big challenge is that lack of communication or that communication barrier. But Selena speaks perfect English and Swahili, of course. I speak perfect English and Swahili. So not only do we have one language that we can express ourselves to each other in, but we have two. And that's a huge, huge, huge help in our relationship. It always has been. It continues to be. So that we both can really understand what the other person is saying or communicating in a conversation or just in daily life. Join the left.
After getting to know each other, they had a wonderful time together, which created a special love between them. They spent a lot of time together, traveled to different places, and enjoyed each other's company. This bond eventually led him to ask her to be his wife. The most amazing thing about their story is this.
When we met with Brian, everything kind of became history, because we were like, we walked across East Africa on foot together for 58 days.
And in 2019, we actually walked together across Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda. So we walked on foot across all three of those countries. It took 58 days, and there is no better way to know someone truly when you've been walking for 15 miles, you still have 10 more miles to go, it's hot, you're carrying a heavy backpack, you're tired, you're hungry, you're thirsty, you're moody, and in that 58 days, we really got to know each other in kind of the harshest conditions you can imagine. An amazing adventure, but a really great way we got to know each other.
It was only after this that their love took a significant step forward as they began the journey of becoming a family. The first step they had to take was to inform their families about their love, which was both a challenge and a joy. Selena had the opportunity to go to America to meet Brian's family, and they were very happy to welcome her as a daughter-in-law. On the other hand, Brian was happy with Selena's family, but due to the culture of the Maasai people, he faced a special test when he met them.
When it came time for Selena to introduce me to her parents and for me to introduce Selena to my parents, everyone was very receptive. My parents love Selena. Selena's been to America 3 times and knows my parents and my brother and my cousins and my aunts and my uncles, and they all love her to death. And when I met Selena's parents, they really accepted me as well. I think for a few reasons. Like I said, being able to speak Swahili and being able to communicate was a huge factor in that, because without that, I would not have been able to effectively talk to Selena's parents. The first time I met Selena's father, I'll never forget, he took a Maasai blanket and he put it over my head like he was going to whisper a secret to me. And right when he was about to speak, he just started spitting in my face. right into my face. And I was shocked. I was like, I was just like blown away. I had no idea what was going on. As it turns out, as I later found out, spitting is a blessing in Maasai. So what he was actually doing was blessing me. And that was the very first time I met him. And I'll never forget that because I was very surprised what was going on. Him spitting in my face underneath this blanket that he put over our head. But we have a great relationship. I think Selena's parents, Selena is a traditional Maasai woman, came from a very traditional Maasai family in a small town called Mossoro in Kajiado. And they face many challenges, some of which are female genital mutilation and early childhood marriage. So many times in Maasai culture, women or girls, I should say, not even women, but girls, get married at, 13, 14, 15, and are pregnant by 13, 14, 15, usually with husbands that are decades older than they are and have multiple other wives. So when I met Selena, she was 25 or so and hadn't given birth yet, hadn't gotten married yet. So in her parents' eyes, I think, they were just happy she found someone. They were wondering if she's ever going to find someone, if she's ever going to have a baby. So I think it was a combination of me being able to effectively communicate with them and have just a good relationship with them. But they were also just happy that Selena found someone, because to them, she was about 10 years too late in terms of the timeline of getting married, starting a family, and having a baby. So in the end, everything worked out. My family loves Selena, and I have a really good relationship with her family as well, and we're both really, really grateful for that.
This time, everything fell into place. They had a beautiful wedding and decided to spend the rest of their lives together. Later on, they were blessed with a beautiful baby girl. They have become a loving family, engaging in various activities that bring them closer and make them feel complete. Despite facing different challenges from time to time, their love for each other remains strong. They continue to grow as a family, achieving many things together and supporting each other through every obstacle.
So yeah, being in cross-cultural and interracial relationship is not a walk in the park. It has its own unique challenges. For example, like in Kenya or in my community, people see like people from the West or white people like really, really like as really wealthy. So everybody thinks that I have a shit ton of money, and they always think that I have money, so they always come to me when they need help. I'm happy to be a hope giver, but sometimes they think that I don't go broke, which is a challenge because yes, I go broke. I go without money sometimes. And also just like expectations and how they think my husband's race is sometimes not so okay. Even though sometimes it's okay that they think that it's okay that they think that I'm a hope giver, because I am one, and I always try my best to support my community. For example, every year we have partnered with different organizations, and we give financial school fees aid to kids from vulnerable families. But also, of course, being here and the other family being in the US is another challenge, because it's a long, long distance, and it's sad that we can't be with our family all the time. We can't be with Brian's family. And it's also a challenge because we want to be together, we want to be in the same place, we want to see each other more oftenly, which does not happen.
Basically, we came to this land in December of 2019, knowing that we wanted to build a house for ourselves. And when we came, it was just a field. Not a structure, not a tree, nothing, just a field. And we built a small house for ourselves, a small kitchen for ourselves, and a small bathroom. And because Selena is passionate about farming, we also started the farm, which is behind us. And that was it. We had no plans to expand into an eco lodge. But what happened, funny enough, is that for the previous 7 years before we moved here, I had been hosting volunteers through my nonprofit organization, volunteers from all around the world. And these volunteers would go back to their home countries, wherever it may be, Australia, England, America, whatever. And they would tell their friends about me and Kenya. And whenever someone wanted to maybe travel to Kenya, and they asked one of our past volunteers, that past volunteer would say, oh, contact Brian. So we started getting guests. Without even trying to get guests, we just started getting people from around the world starting to come. At the same time, we started to make local friends here, and they would come and they would hang out, and eventually they would bring alcohol, and we'd have a great time because we'd, you know, have a party and all that. But in the morning, I'd have to go around and pick up all the trash, and we weren't making any money. At the same time, a German guy came here, and he asked if he could take a video of my wife explaining all about our organic farm. And we said, sure, why not? So he took a small video, and we forgot about it. A few months later, he posted it on YouTube, and right now it's got a million-something views. It went viral, and we just started getting messages from people all around the world asking if they can come visit. And at the same time, Selena got pregnant with our first daughter, Zuri. So we said, oh, crap. People have already decided to come here. People are going to continue to come here. We have to have a place for them to sleep, because at the time, the only place to hang out was inside our small house. The only place for them to sleep was our guest bedroom inside our house. So we said, if people have decided to come here, why don't we take advantage of that and turn what we've created into an actual business and make money from it? And that's where the idea of Bomanoma Eco Lodge and Organic Farm came from. So it's not that we came here with the idea to build an Eco Lodge, but more so the fact that people decided to come here, and the demand brought the supply. So over the next few years, 2021, 2022, we constructed our tiki bar, three private cottages, the family house, the honeymoon suite, the dormitory, gazebos, everything basically to host people from all around the world. And so far, we've hosted people from 55 or 56 different countries. We've hosted digital nomads who come and work remotely from their laptop. We're totally off-grid here, so we use solar, but we do have Wi-Fi. So someone can come here and rent a cottage for a month and be able to work remotely on their laptop using our Wi-Fi and be totally fine, totally... they can have everything they need. And then once they're done working, they hop over to the tiki bar and they can enjoy the rest of their night. So we've hosted permaculture workshops from people all around the world who come because of the farm. They're interested in permaculture and regenerative agriculture. But basically what we have now is an eco lodge that consists of different types of accommodations, all made from cob. So cob's a natural style building. So everything we do here is as environmentally sustainable and self-sustainable as possible. We have a full restaurant. We have a full tiki bar, which is awesome. We have multiple gazebos in different places, balconies where people can hang out, come with friends. And we cater to both international guests who might come and spend anywhere from a day to a month here at Bomanoma, but also the local people. We didn't want to be a place where foreigners come and they're separated from the local culture and the local community, because there's plenty of hotels that do that. If you want to go on safari, for example, and be sequestered away from basically the world around you and only see it as you pass by in your Land Cruiser with the window closed, Bomanoma is not for you. So this is one of the many balconies we have here at Bomanoma, another place that people love to come hang out and catch some sun during the day, have a few drinks at night. You can see on this side is the eco lodge, and behind you on that side is the farm. So from here, we're gonna work our way over to the eco lodge, the tiki bar, the cottages, the gazebos, and some other cool stuff that is behind me.
This place that we have created together has become a place where dreams are born. People come here, they get inspired, and they go and create their own spaces. And here in Bomanoma, it's not only an organic farm and ecology, but also even the way we have built our cottages, the techniques we've used to build, it's a natural building technique which takes care of the earth. So we use our cottages where guests sleep are made of cob, which is a mix of sand soil, clay soil, and wheat straw, and has very, very less carbon footprint. So the manyatas, the Maasai traditional housing, are similar, but now how we have built our cottages, it's more durable and more like semi-permanent. So it has, like, I'm really happy that we were able to create this space, and people come and get inspiration, and they can dream even more, and they can come and hang out and spend time with family, meditate and have a good time. So for me, I think Bomanoma has been more than a home for us, but a home for everyone who visits here, whether local or international. And that's why we have like around 56 different nationals that have been to this place. And we appreciate of the lessons they bring us here and the lessons we are also able to give them to go and make their places better than they left them.
We didn't really want it to be Maasai themed per se, even though we are in Maasai land and all of our neighbors are Maasai. We didn't want it to be Maasai themed. Because Selena and I had walked across Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda, because we had traveled throughout East Africa pretty extensively, we've slept in places that are the dingiest places you've ever seen and some of the most luxurious places you've ever seen. Everything from, you know, $3 a night to $3,000 a night. And when we were designing Bomanoma, we basically wanted to design a place where we would like to be. A place where if we arrived, we would like it. And that's why you see different aspects of different African cultures worked in and weaved in throughout Bomanoma. We definitely wanted it to be authentically African. We didn't want someone to come here and it be this big skyscraper where they get in an elevator and by the time they're in their room, they have no idea if they're in Kenya or if they're in, you know, New York City. We wanted it to be authentically African, clean, comfortable, safe, but not specifically attached to one tribe in Kenya. So that's why you see certain aspects. For example, the houses are made of cob material, which is not traditionally Maasai, but it is a traditional natural building style of Africa. The roofs are made of makuti, which are dried coconut palm leaves. That's a style used mostly in Mombasa, but we use it because it keeps the rooms cool and we like the aesthetics, and it's a very authentic African and Kenyan way of building. So when you come here, you'll see kind of a combination of different aspects of Kenyan culture, but authentically African, safe, comfortable, and really that's something that we're very proud of, to be able to build it in that style. And another thing that is even harder to do than to build is to create a vibe, because I think a vibe has to really come organically. And one of the best compliments that I get about Bomanoma, and I get this compliment a lot, is that the moment they walk through our gate and the moment they enter into Bomanoma, they feel like they're at home. And to me, that's the best compliment, because it means that they're comfortable, they're happy, and that is kind of the exact vibe we were trying to create. And like I said, that can only be created organically, and I think we've done a really good job at that. During my time at Bomanoma, there's never been a dull moment, and something that happens quite often is that Kenyan women will come and ask me to help them find a white husband. And those are their words, not mine. And that's always a challenge for me, because a lot of times they're doing it just because they think white people, as a stereotype, have money. And of course, if a woman is looking for a relationship only to benefit financially, then that relationship is not gonna work, most likely. So a lot of times I try and tell them that, you know, yes, I've married a Maasai woman from Kenya, and yes, she's married a white person, but it wasn't about the money. It was because we loved each other. So try and find someone who you love, and everything will work out after that. But there are some women here who I know very well, and we've known each other for a long time, and I know that they have very good hearts and are really morally good people, and they're just looking for someone who can give them a better opportunity in life and who will treat them in the right way. So instead of using the word a white person, I think what they really mean is a good quality man. And maybe for them in Kenya, they haven't found that, so they automatically kind of think that it could be a white person that they're looking for. And if that's the case, and I know the woman, and I know that she's a good person, and I've known her for a long time, then of course, sometimes I try and play matchmaker. We have so many guests that come through here, and many of them are single white men, and many of them are keen to mingle. So sometimes Bomanoma has been a place where two people have fallen in love, or at least begun dating. It's happened before. And that's always a lot of fun when that happens. But for me, I try and make sure it's organic as possible and make sure that both parties are in it for the right reasons. But then, of course, I remove myself. Everyone lives their own life. I'm not going to intrude on anyone's decisions. So, you know, once two people meet, my work is over. I remove myself. Whatever happens, happens, and it's their decision.
As soon as we had this conversation, we took the time to learn more about their place, Bomanoma. The first thing that surprised us was how they welcomed every guest from a new country.
So we've hung the Rwandan flag here because for the first time in Bomanoma's 3-year history, we have had a guest from Rwanda. So that is our now 55th or 56th flag that we've hung here, which means he is the 56th person to come from a different country to Bomanoma.
Not only that, but we also had the opportunity to visit every part of the area. It is a truly beautiful place, with everything being pleasing to the eye. The lobby, the rooms, the bar, and all other parts of this place are so beautiful that every visitor can enjoy them.
So this is our bonfire. Here we like to hang out at night with some drinks and some music and just have a good time. As you can see, it was used last night and the coals are still hot. I can feel it even from here. But this is a popular place. Once the sun goes down at Bomanoma, this is a popular place to hang out.
Another great thing is that we had the chance to learn more about the area, as there are many things here with strong meanings.
We have millet seeds. Millets. So we are not just an ecolodge, but we also have a permaculture farm, which is a demonstration farm for the local community and also our guests to learn about regenerative agriculture, and we share seeds with them, and some of our farmer friends also bring us seeds. So this is our seed bank, and we are 100% organic, so we don't use any pesticides, and we try our best to use indigenous seeds, which we really want to multiply so that we can prevent them from extinction, and then we are able to share with our neighbors, because the indigenous seeds, most of them, they're self-regenerating. So we really, it's really even cheaper to do indigenous seeds and also local seeds, because they are also adapted to the climate better. So in our nursery, we have some chives and lettuce. The lettuce are growing. And so this are coriander, dania. We planted several herbs here, dill, oregano. So we hope to transplant them into the main plot soon. Mandala garden. So mandala is a Hindu concept that means circular. So as you see, everything is going in circular motion. It represents the universe. Our mandala is for healing, first of all, because we planted all these different herbs. For example, we have 4 different types of mint. So healing. You can get several home remedies from here. We have all different herbs that we not only use as home remedies, but also we use them as spices and
to help our ecosystem balanced and keep away pests. And it's also for teaching, because our community is still so new to crop farming. Originally and traditionally, as the Maasais, we've been nomadic pastoralists, and now we are having to live in the in one place that is designated for us. They're giving us title deeds, so we are like confined in one place. And traditionally we moved around, and that's how we got to name most of Kenya, including our capital city, Nairobi. It's Maasai word for the cold place. So right now, of course, with climate change and changing rain patterns, and also with unpredictable rains, we really cannot depend on our animals 100% like before, like when I was growing up. So I have taken the lead to learn about permaculture and different designs, and how to create, how to design sustainable ecosystems that do not compromise future generations, and also that takes care of the earth, takes care of the people, and takes care of the future. And we have done that by creating Bomanoma, which is a garden that is a learning space, a demonstration space for our neighbors, and also for guests that come here. And they come and just learn different types of organic farming, different types of gardening, including this mandala, which makes use of the circular space. And they're able to go and implement them in their homes. And that way, we are able to address household poverty, household hunger, because a lot of women, one of their main challenges here, and I think it's worldwide, one of the big problems or challenges that women have is the inability to feed their children.
If you want to know more or visit this place and learn about this family, it is very possible. There is a lot to learn from them in many different ways.
So again, for all of that information, all of our accommodations, all about the farm, everything we offer, all the different excursions, you know, planning safaris, hiking Mount Longonot, going to Zanzibar, everything. www.bomanoma.com, and it has pictures, it has information, it has all the information you would ever need, and it has an area to contact us. So if you are interested in coming, I would love for you to reach out, because Karibu Sana, which means welcome very much to Bomanoma. We would love to see you here.
Anyway, will you guys have some coffee or chai? I have some coffee here. Zuri! Hi.
We have witnessed many love stories, each showing us the power and brilliance of love. How do you feel about love? I believe the true meaning is captured in this story. To conclude, let me say, love is seeing beyond skin color. Love is embracing each other's cultures. Love is uniting hearts across all boundaries. Thank you for watching. I am Simon Greenwood, and this is Afrimax English. Don't forget to subscribe.